So what to expect at CR? First of all, no boundaries, all right? It's crazy town, just go nuts, all right? I mean, CR can also stand for crazy revolution, you know? I mean, it can stand for creative revolt, you know? I mean, just okay, get out there, yeah, don't let anybody stop you,
okay, hey,
you
know? No. I'm going to stop you, okay? All right. Boundaries are important. Boundaries are almost the spine of what Celebrate Recovery is all about. We need boundaries, all right? Boundaries helps us know what our addictions are, how to stay away from them, temptations, all of that. Boundaries are a really, really good thing. You know what? I'll just spin it, okay? All right? Okay, let's, for what you can expect, you can expect not to put any boundaries on what God is going to do at CR, okay? All right? Okay? All right? Romans 8:1, there is no condemnation in Christ, all right? So let's not put any boundaries on what God can do in our hearts, our souls, and our minds, all right?
I was going to say that.
No, you
I
weren't.
Was.
No,
I was.
No.
I was taking the scenic route to get there.
No,
you went right there.
You jumped off. No, you jumped off a cliff.
No, I was headed right there. That's where I was going. Right there.
You were going right there.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Oh,
what?
I can't do it, can I?
What?
Oh, me. Oh, I haven't been through the 12 rules. Oh, look at me. I'm just helpless. Oh, I'm not you. I'm not. Oh, look at me. Oh, I'm Eddie. I've been through the 12 steps. Oh, John Baker was my sponsor. Oh, I'm a part of CR royalty. Oh. I was helpless, and John Baker scooped me up in his arms and held me. He looked at me and said, "Oh, little bald baby, let me take care of you. Papa John has you. Have some pizza."
Hey, you were talking, okay? And I was just trying to help.
Oh, don't, no. Do not interrupt me. You just crosswalked me right there. I know how this works. I had a green light and you just crosswalked me right there.
It's called crosstalk, and I did not crosstalk you. It's okay. There was no crosstalk. You know.
You better watch yourself.
You
better check yourself before you wreck yourself. Huh?
When people are squeezed, we see what comes out in their character.
Oh, I'm about to squeeze you.
Okay. I think you need to settle down, take some deep breaths, and maybe make amends here, okay? All right? Okay?
No. Buddy, I would never do that to you.
You would never make amends?
I would never make amends to you. No, I mean, we may get, you know, but we're friends, okay? And friends don't amend because that leads to the end.
What are you
right?
doing?
No, shh. Listen. No, that's fine. That's fine. That leads me to my next one, okay? The second thing that you can expect at CR is to make amends. And that means that what you're going to do is make a list of all those who hurt you, and then you're going to exercise your Second Amendment right. And you are going to come down and rain down fire on the people that hurt you. That's what's going to happen. You will exercise that Second Amendment right to bear arms. It is like the Hunger Games meets the Purge, all in one. You're gonna rain down fire on them. And just when they think you're done, you're gonna grab them by the collar and pull them close with your best Batman voice and say, "You did this to me." Eight is great. With me, eight is great.
No, 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 no.
Eight is great.
What are you?
is great!
No. Step eight, you've totally twisted it into some creepy, morbid thing. No, that's not why. What making amends is all about. Making amends is taking care of your side of the tracks. I mean, it's getting yourself right with others and with God, okay? It's a very beautiful thing, all right? We are here because we have to make amends to people and to God and get our lives right, all right? That's what making amends is.
That's weird.
No. No, it's very beautiful.
That's bizarre.
No, it's
that
very...
That makes no sense.
It makes a lot of sense. Okay, it's really, really good stuff.
I'm confused.
Okay, you know what? I think you just need to look at some of your shortcomings, and maybe that can help. I'm just...
Whoa. You're going to look up at me and say I'm short? Huh? I'm pretty steady 6 foot right here. What are you, 5 foot and some change? You're almost an Oompa Loompa, is what you are.
You know what? Maybe I think I'm just gonna take over now, okay?
No, sir. No, sir. That's called control, all right? I got you, Mr. Control Freak.
No,
I got
you.
No, I'll finish what I start.
Okay. You're on number 3.
Thank you. I know what I'm on. Okay, number 3, the third thing that you can expect at CR is you can expect your stuff to be stolen or damaged. Right? So, as a precautionary thing, what you're going to want to do is make an inventory of all the things that you brought. It's apparently a part of an insurance program that John has over all the CRs, even the ones in Sweden, which they really, be careful, but... Yeah, and just seriously, even if it just has sentimental value, make that inventory, write it down, just to make sure that, because like I said, if it gets lost or damaged, that's the thing. Ain't got nothing to add to that, do you, buddy?
Nailed it. You said lost or damaged. I'm beginning to think you may be damaged.
Aren't we all? Isn't that why we're here? I mean... correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's number one. That's rule number one. Admit we're damaged, right?
Paraphrasing. Okay. My question is, I don't even think you know what step number 3 is.
What's number 3?
Step number 3 is what you do after number 1, do after number 2.
Buddy, no, uh-uh. They're smarter than that. Don't resort to potty humor, okay?
I wasn't.
Oh, did you go number 1? Did you go number 2? Time for number 3! No, buddy, come on. Though that's low-hanging comedy fruit.
I wasn't doing that at all.
Buddy,
I was just trying
just
to...
own up to it,
I wasn't
right?
doing that at all.
You know.
You want me to just take one?
Fine. That's fine.
Okay.
Captain, I know how to do it all.
No.
Yeah, you go ahead. No, see how hard it is to talk to these people, all right? It's not me, it's them, all right?
What you can expect at CR, you can expect personally, collectively, regionally, that when you do the possible, God is going to do the impossible in your life. And What I love about the 12 steps is when you get down to number 12, we get to take this great news and we get to go give it away. We get to spread the good news to people. And we get to help the hurting, the people that have habits and hang-ups, and we get to let them see Jesus and let them get free. And that is a beautiful, beautiful thing you can expect.
That is beautiful. No, that's fantastic. If I could just wrap it up. And those are the five things you can expect at CR.
No, don't clap for him. That was only four. You botched inventory, you dismantled amendments, and you had no clue what a boundary was, and I just did the spiritual expectation thing for Quattro.
And fine. Number five, you know what you can expect? I'll just tell you. Lord, guess what? You, and I'll tell you, I shouldn't even have come out here. I failed at this. I am not good at it. I can't do it. I'm no good. That's what you can expect. That's the fifth you can expect. That's number five.
You're right. That is number five. And what we can expect, we can leave the past behind because we are moving forward because God is doing a new thing. Thank you.
Aren't you glad that we all have a story? We all have a story. We're all in a place along our journey. But it's not in ourselves that we get to boast. But we get to boast in what He does in and through us. If I told
justice was served, and for mercy.
song, praising my Savior all the day long. Sing it out with us. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. This morning, we want you to be able to hear a story. A story that is an incredibly profound statement, not of the person, but of the graciousness of God. And so I'd like for you all to be seated. I'm going to invite Robin to come and to share with us. And I'm sure that she's probably going to share that this is probably one of the most difficult things that she's ever done. But you know, the amazing thing is just like we've read about in Luke, and you've heard me say over the last couple of weeks, if we don't share our story, if we don't share our testimony, if we don't give glory to God, then the rocks are going to cry out. I don't want a rock to cry out in my place. You know, John Wesley shared that whenever you were to share your story or your testimony, it was only supposed to be about a week. A week. Our story, the testimony that we share, we should be sharing about what Jesus is doing in our life now. Not necessarily just what he did. You know, just what he did in our lives years ago. But what is he doing now? How is he working and speaking through us and to us now? Okay. That's okay. Oh,
I am a grateful believer in Jesus Christ who celebrates freedom, sweet, sweet freedom from drugs, alcohol, bulimia, lust, and self-loathing that led to self-injury and suicidal obsession. God is healing me from childhood abuse and neglect, divorce of my parents, divorce from my husband, and chronic illness. I struggle with worry that I won't get what I think I want and what I feel I want. God has taught me through CR that what I need and what I want are two different things. God has taught me through CR that God knows far better what I need than I do.
God has taught me through CR that what I want is not a horrible, evil thing. I want myself and the people in my life to experience a sense of safety, meaning, purpose, being alive, and being loved. Horrible, evil problems occur when I rely on my own power to make these things happen, right, instead of relying on God's power. God has taught me through a CR that this is a basic element of human beings. It is out of my own power that I chose to use drugs, alcohol, the approval of people, food, and money to get what I want. When I and or the people in my life are not experiencing a sense of safety, meaning, purpose, being alive, being loved, there's sadness, fear, and anger. When there's sadness, fear, and anger, I want to know why.
God has taught me through CR that only God knows the truth. My human mind will never comprehend God's mind. God created us with a free will and the choices we make out of sadness, anger, and fear when often cause great harm. I need to allow God to transform my sadness to joy, anger to love, and fear to hope and peace. Then make the choice out of joy, love, and faith inspired by God's will.
And when I and or the people in my life are sad, afraid, and angry, I want to know how I can make it better. God has taught me through CR that only God can heal. Only God can work miracles. Only God can restore. Only God can resurrect, create life, and transform. I can only do God's will in the current moment if I'm aware of my will. I stop. I breathe. I pray to do God's will. And then I wait for God's power to strengthen me. Then I act in obedience and trust to God's will. And when I or the people in my life are sad, angry, afraid, I want to know when it will be better. God has taught me through CR that a lifetime of human suffering is nothing compared to a moment of spiritual bliss. Amen. What is 100 years of suffering compared to eternity with God? Amen. The root of my suffering is worry. Why? How? When? My worry is the result of tremendous fear. I grew up in a church, at least weekly learning. And I learned before I was 8 years old what I should do. I learned about us, and I learned about them. I learned that those people did bad things. And that's why bad things happened or will happen to them. I learned that those people did good things. And that's why good things happened or will happen to them. And bad things happened to me. And I kept secrets. When I did bad things, I tried to hide. I was very good at hiding. I tried my very best to do what I knew I should do. When I did good things, I worried it wouldn't be good enough. I worried people would find out about the bad things I did or the bad things that happened. I worried that people would find out the truth about me. I worried that worse things would happen to me. I was afraid, I was sad, I was angry. God has taught me through CR that the natural function of sadness, fear, and anger is to motivate me to hold tighter to God's promise and rely on God's power. Problems started when I tried to rely on my own power. I avoided and distracted myself from the sadness, anger, and fear by comparing the bad things I was doing to those people who did worse things. I compared the bad things I was currently doing to the worst things I used to do. I tried to learn more so I could know better to do better. God has taught me through CR that human knowledge is very different from God's spiritual wisdom. God has taught me through CR that Jesus Christ is the example of every spiritual wisdom I need to practice. Instead of the fleshly knowledge I was born with and the worldly knowledge I have learned from birth, I can become hypnotized by the illusion of the greatness of my human knowledge. Thoughts like, I got this, I'm fine, I'm not broken, or I'm too broken. I can do it by myself. I know who they really are. These thoughts signal me that I'm not listening for God's will. God has taught me through CR to wake up, be more aware of the reality of God's wisdom, so that I am able to participate with obedience and trust in God's miracles, God's healing, God's restoration, God's transformation, God's resurrection and creation of life. It is in this participation of obedience and trust that I receive God's blessings of passionate joy, unconditional love, endless hope, peace that passes understanding. This is freedom. Sweet, sweet freedom. And it's not dependent on the good or bad I do. It is dependent on God's grace and God's mercy. God has taught me through CR that I need God. I need the Holy Spirit and others to show courage to talk about secrets and things we are wanting to hide. I need to follow the example of Jesus Christ to embrace the outcasts of society. That's me. And radiate his healing love. God has taught me through CR to be aware that we are human and God is God. There is no us or them or those people. You're a God.
God, through CR, we are all God's precious human beings in desperate need of God's power. God, through CR, reminds me to be more aware of God's voice. God, through CR, reminds me to surrender my will every moment. I become aware I am acting out of my mind, will, emotion, and desire. God through CR reminds me to hold tighter to God's promises by letting go of the things that distract me from being aware of God's voice. I need to stop comparing, avoiding, hiding, and keeping secrets. I need to stop relying on my own power and consciously connect with God's power. God has used CR to remind me to surrender deeper, become more aware, and celebrate freedom. Sweet, sweet freedom.
Thank you. So I am a grateful believer in Jesus Christ, who celebrates freedom. Sweet, sweet freedom from drugs, alcohol, bulimia, lust, and self-loathing that led to self-injury and suicidal obsession. God is healing me from childhood abuse and neglect, divorce of my parents, divorce from my husband, and chronic illness. I struggle with worry that I won't get what I want and what I feel I want. God has taught me through CR that I need what I need and want are two very different things. God has taught me through CR that God knows far better what I need than I do.
Amen. Just stay up here for just a second. Yeah, if you don't mind, if it's okay. You know, in the life of the church, it's very rare people get standing ovations, right? But I'm so thankful that Trinity is a church that will always stand for what God has done in people's lives. And I have to share with you, a few months ago, and Robin and I have been getting to know each other a little bit more as she has been attending Trinity, and I said to her in the back, I said, "Robin, your countenance has changed." Do you remember that? Her countenance. Not just who she is, not just the way that she carries herself or or conversations, but literally her countenance changed. And I said, Robin, what has God done in your life? And she said, Pastor, it was a Friday night. It was Good Friday. Good Friday night. When we connect and we join with Celebrate Recovery. And we do that on purpose. Folks, we do it on purpose. I've spent the last 4 years of ministry trying to break down the walls between Celebrate Recovery and the church. Because we don't know it, but we do. We create walls, don't we? And so we intentionally get together on Good Friday, and we intentionally partner with Celebrate Recovery. I tell people all the time that our weekend celebration, our weekend worship starts on Friday. And it was in that service that God restored Robin. And the amazing thing was, she didn't tell me about it. She didn't have to say anything because her countenance changed. What God was doing in her and through her was so evident. And we are so blessed as a church to walk along the journey, all of our journeys, because all we like sheep have gone astray. All of us are broken. All of us struggle. And Robin, I am so thankful that you shared. And I hope that Robin's testimony for maybe some of you sitting here today, this morning, is a testimony of hope and a testimony that God's not done with you yet. He is never done with any of us. No matter if you've been a Christian for 5 minutes, 5 years, or 50, he is never done with us. Let's keep trusting in him and journeying with him along life's road. Thank you, Robin. Appreciate it.
Maybe for you, Robin didn't read off something that you struggle with. But the fact is, we've all got chains. We've all got chains that have bind us before. And it's only by God's grace that we break free of those chains. Why don't you stand with us?
His word, my
This morning, I feel very, very led to recognize that some of you here, standing here, sitting here this morning, you're carrying chains you're not meant to carry. You're carrying burdens. Either you've picked them back up or you've never let them go. But this morning, you're carrying chains and you desire to experience the grace and the freedom and the forgiveness that can only be found in Christ Jesus. And so I want to you right now, if the Lord has spoken to you about letting go of these chains, about giving it all over to Him, whatever it is you've either picked up or you've never let go, right now I want you just to simply step out and just come to an altar of prayer, just to a place where you can come, and we're going to have people that are going to pray with you. And again, this isn't me. I just feel led this morning just to offer this opportunity. If you want to experience God's grace, His forgiveness, then we're just going to sing. We're just going to sing through that chorus just one more time. And during that time, I want the house lights to stay up. I need the house lights to stay up. I want you at that time to simply just step out. I want you to be able to see, to get out and come down. So would you do that? My chains are gone. You want to be able to proclaim, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a dove, His mercy flows. Unending love, amazing grace. Let's sing that song. And then if you just want to step out and pray, come on out. Come on out. Just let's go meet with Him. Come on.
My chains are gone. I've been saved.
we can make sure that we have pastoral staff come down and pray with those. This morning, our special guest that's actually here, I see her, and I'm going to invite Jackie to come and to share with us this morning. I know I'm putting her very much on the spot. Jackie is a pastor in Durban at the House of Hope Church of the Nazarene. Her and her husband, Titus, both serve there. She may look and sound familiar. She's John and Mary Govender's daughter. And so, now listen. The House of Hope, or the House of Prayer Church, has a deliverance ministry that they gather together and they pray very specifically about how God would deliver people that are experiencing incredible amount of spiritual oppression and physical oppression and mental oppression. And so I want us to listen carefully to what God has for us this morning in this moment. When we pray, God, my chains are gone, we want to know that, Lord, I picked it up and I want to put it back down. Or God, I've never let it go, and I really want to just let it go. Jackie, would you come and would you share with us this morning? And I'd invite you just to be seated or take whatever posture is most comfortable for you. Good morning. Hey, pleasure to meet you.
I greet you in Jesus' precious name. I was looking forward to being with you this morning, and I was asking the Lord, what shall I share with Trinity Church this morning? What would you lay upon my heart? And I've read the Bible through and through from cover to cover several times, and there was no scripture that God would release to me except this one. And before I get into scripture, I just want to greet you from my church house of prayer. We are in Durban. We are on the south side of Africa. More about that later. Let's go into what God is saying. I'm reading from the book of Acts chapter 1 from verse 4. And I will read this portion which says, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And I continue in verse 8, and it says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." A few months ago, God had placed the scripture upon our heart, and I was sharing it with a group of women. We meet on Friday nights and we pray. I was sharing it with them, and suddenly it felt like we were in the upper room. And there was such an outpouring of God's presence and His Spirit. Not long from that time when we were praying, we went on a mission trip. We went to Swaziland, and it was mostly women that went on that trip. And when we got there, we saw why God was saying, "My Spirit will come upon you." And the great and good news is, church, that God's Spirit is upon each of us this morning. Amen. Wherever we are, I come from a great, big, wonderful continent where it's very hot. It's called Africa. But I want to tell you that God's Spirit is alive, is Amen. Moving, Amen. Is pulsating, is vibrating, is breaking down chains, is lifting barriers, is pushing boundaries, is crossing borders. And there is no government on earth that can contain the Spirit of God. There is no government on earth that can say, "No, you cannot cross this border. You will not enter this territory," because God's Spirit is moving throughout the earth. And like He said in His Word, if you will wait for me, if you will tarry with me, if you will just stay and wait, then I will come. And that is what God wanted me to share with you this morning. I do miss my church back home, but I feel that I am at home this morning. Thank you for the welcome. Thank you, Pastor Steve. Thank you for the welcome. And I believe God is doing a great big work over there in the corner. But I want to share with you that God is busy. And it's not that God needs to get with our program. We need to get with His program. Because he is moving. He is busy in Africa. We see great and mighty things happen. We see Hindus coming to the Lord. We see Muslims coming to the Lord. On the trip to Swaziland, we took a 19-year-old man, a young boy, a young man. He was just, he had just given his heart to the Lord 2 months, and he wanted to go on this trip with us, and he comes from the Muslim faith. So we are busy mentoring him. We are training him and discipling him. Pray for us. There's a lot of work in Africa, just like there's a lot of work here. So God be with you. It was great to be with you. My husband is also a pastor, and we co-pastor House of Prayer Church of the Nazarene. And this morning he sent me a message and said another new family joined our church. 2016, the Lord has declared for House of Prayer is the year of explosion. We are crossing boundaries and barriers. We're just breaking down chains. And you know, the enemy is busy setting up chains wherever he goes, but the power of God is there to bring release and deliverance. I love you all. God bless you. Amen. Would I pray? Yes. I've been requested to pray. Is there a special request or any? Okay. All right, let's pray. Shall we close our eyes? Our Father in heaven, we come to you this morning through the mighty name of Jesus Christ. There is no other name greater than that. And today, Lord, we bow before you and we say, Lord, thank you for connecting. Thank you for the great connections that you make, spiritual connections, physical connections, people connections. Thank you, my God, that you have connected House of Prayer with Trinity Church and all the other churches throughout the world. I pray, Lord, for this Church of the Nazarene right here. I pray, God, that you will bless them. I pray you will raise up many, many warriors. I pray you will raise up many, many intercessors. I pray you will raise up pastors. I pray you will raise up apostles. I pray you will raise up teachers. I pray you will raise up preachers, my God, those who will go into the youth ministry, the children ministry, the adult ministry, the women's ministry. We pray, Lord, there will be those that will be called to go out across boundaries and barriers, across borders, my God, those who will be called to the mission field. We pray for those that will serve right here in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria. We pray that Trinity Church will explode, my God, in ways they never thought possible. We pray for a double portion of your anointing, that the mantle of Elijah will rest upon those you appoint this morning. We pray, God, for your servant who will share that prayer. You will bless him. I pray for Pastor Steve and his staff and those, the pastoral staff and additional staff. We pray, God, for those who are in music, those who are in worship. We pray for the Sunday school department, the youth department. We pray for those who are in missions. Thank you, Lord, for those also that are serving outside the church. We pray you will bless each one. Father, thank you for what you're doing here this morning. Thank you for Celebrate Recovery. We pray, Lord, that many more people will be drawn to the church through Celebrate Recovery. We know the world is hurting. They are broken. They cannot be fixed outside Jesus Christ. But we thank you for the church that reaches out. Bless us this morning, Father, as we celebrate your love, your glory, your mercy and your greatness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Jackie, thank you so much for being with us. And this is the first time that we've met officially.
We have one father.
That's right, that's right. And Jackie, I know that you didn't know this, but we've been reading through the New Testament and we're doing a chapter a day. The last two times that we've read, Friday and Saturday, was Acts 1 and Acts 2. So it's the spirit of unity that we pray for, and I want you to know that we diligently pray along with you for God's spirit to do incredible things, not just here, but around the world, and we get to participate in that. So thank you. Is Taryn with you? Is she... Oh, there's Taryn. Hi, Taryn. Would you just stand for us? This is John and Mary's other daughter, who's also here this morning, Taryn. So thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. And would you just join me as we just pray a special blessing over over God's tithes and our offerings this morning, gracious Lord. This morning, we're eager to hear from you. We've already heard from you. But Lord, we're selfish this morning. We want to hear more. We want to hear more from you. We want to know that your Holy Spirit is guiding us into all truth. We want to know, Lord, that again, as we experience that spirit of unity, Lord, through that bond of peace. And thank you so much for the ministry of Jackie and Titus in the House of Prayer Church of the Nazarene in Durban. Lord, we pray now for the receiving of your tithes and our offerings. And Lord, you know that the only way that we have a church in South Africa is because of a global understanding of the mission that you have called us to. Lord, I'm so right now challenged. I know that our mission is to serve and love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. But Lord, we have been commissioned to take it out into the world around us. So Lord, may this offering be a step of faith where we say, Lord, we want to continue the mission and ministry, not just here at Trinity, but also around the world. So we proclaim it in your name, and we give it all to you in your name. Amen.
I see broken, but you see beautiful, and you're helping me to believe that you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You washed me. Dead now lives again. My heart's beating inside my chest, and I'm coming alive with joy and destiny. I am clean.
know what I'm doing up here. I mean, service says it's done, right? Right? I was fearful of whether he was going to show up or not, and it's evident he's here, and I could probably just go home and save myself all this anxiety, right? And I apologize if you were looking forward to hearing the pastor speak, okay? But unfortunately, you get to hear me. So hopefully I don't see anybody going up. Well, actually, I hope you don't hear from me. I hope you hear from him. It's amazing that we're here again. 7 years. We've done 6 years. We just wrapped it up, and we're moving forward. Amen?
Amen.
Have any CR people that want to acknowledge that? I mean, all right. Now, I have to tell you, for someone who never thought they could get up in front of people and speak, and I did flunk speech class, I have become quite comfortable with speaking at Celebrate Recovery on Friday nights. However, standing here in front of all of you is a different story. My heart is beating fast. My hands are sweaty. I'm pretty sure I ate a bunch of salt because there's nothing left inside me. My mouth is dry. And I'm thinking, what are you thinking? Meaning, are you thinking, great, CR Sunday. I love it when they do this once a year. Or are you sitting there thinking, great, CR Sunday. We could have stayed home today. I'm glad they only do it once a year. Hopefully it's the first one. And we can be honest here, can't we? Now look, I'm not going to kid myself here. I know that I'm not Pastor Steve. I know that I'm not Pastor Tony or Pastor Herb. Or even a Hal Perkins. But that's okay. I don't need to be any of them, right? Because I'm Tim Sims. Don't push the ego too much, all right? But I got to tell you, if CR Sunday would have been a few weeks back, I would have been trying to find any and all reasons to not be up here. But as Pastor led on Sunday, he gave us Luke 19:47 and 48. Every day he was teaching at the temple, but chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the leaders were among the people who were trying to kill him. Yet they could not find any way to do it because all the people hung on his words. So something started stirring in me right away, and he concluded with this part where we had to insert our name. After Jesus cleaned Tim's temple and made it a house of prayer, Jesus began to teach Tim daily. But Tim's physical, spiritual, and emotional adversaries didn't like this and started planning on how to hurt me. But Tim's adversaries couldn't do a thing. Because you see, Tim hung on every word Jesus said. And what God was saying to me was, you, Tim Sims, need to tell Trinity why CR is so important. You need to show them what I have done in your house. And don't forget, we had talked for days about discipleship with Hal during Maranatha. He was telling me, be my disciple. And he kept prompting me, say something. So as I was sitting in service last Sunday, I was literally overwhelmed with all these words and images of CR Sunday. I really felt his presence was telling me something. But of course, I went on my day. And I began my week, I went to work, and Tuesday, it was happening again. So I thought, you know, this obedience thing, whatever that looks like, was, maybe I should write this down and send it to the pastor. Maybe he could use it for CR Sunday. So I believed the Holy Spirit was prompting me, and I felt I had to be that obedience. And after finishing it, I thought, wow, this is pretty good. This is pretty good. The good news is he should be able to use some of it for his sermon. Yeah, look how that worked out. And he responded to my email after I sent it. Sometimes he doesn't respond for a while, but it was like, you know. Basically, and Pastor Steve's, you know, that southern little bit drawl, you know, was, yeah, I'm sorry, but you're going to need to do the sermon on Sunday. The shock of that didn't hit me till about Thursday. And here I stand trying to do my best to be obedient, to step out of that comfortable zone and be uncomfortable in front of you. Shaking very much. But Luke 28, Jesus said, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. So I prayed that he would use me to share what he wanted me to say, not what I wanted to say. So I'm not up here to share my story, because you guys have heard many clips of it. I'm here to talk to Trinity about Trinity. Now, most of you know I've only been in this faith business for about 9.5 years. And by no means am I claiming that I know more than anyone else. But what I do know is that for 6 years, we have promoted this wonderful ministry of Celebrate Recovery. For 6 years, we have encountered the same struggles, the devil trying to shut it down. We should have approximately 15 to 20 leaders to run this ministry. For the most part, we have done this with 8 to 10. We average about 16 people a week, which has been a downslide from about 30 people at the beginning of the year. Most of us have been exhausted with running this ministry. Full-time jobs, children, the work week, and then putting the ministry together. This year was extremely hard for me, and a month ago, I was done, and it had been working on me for a while. But I finally came to a conclusion a couple weeks back. You see, one of my leaders, Amy, we all know Amy, right? Don't we just love her? Huh? See, she had learned some things through CR. So she said to me, please don't make any decision based off your feelings. That kind of stung. That stung. Because this was me. And I needed to look at the acrostic that we use many times, and that is HALT. Which means, am I hungry? Am I angry? Am I lonely? Or am I tired? Ephesians 5:15 through 17 says, look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand the will of the Lord. The problem was there was so much going on in our lives. I was physically exhausted, mentally exhausted, and spiritually disconnected. Basically, I was at a point of being deaf. And what I mean by that is I couldn't hear what God was telling me to do, and I couldn't hear what the devil was telling me to do, which was a good thing. Oh, the doubts I had. And the doubts had me questioning everything. Sound familiar? If we take a look at John 20, 27 and 29, then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And I had to follow that up with Mark 9, 23, 24. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for one who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me with my unbelief. Wow. That is exactly what I needed. Because doubting Tim needed to believe. I needed help with my unbelief. So the decision was made. Not that I had an answer, just a decision. And that was to move forward in faith. Faith that eventually God would tell me what to do and he would make it abundantly clear. Good news is I put the email together to all the leaders, and the minute I hit that send button, the weight of the world was off my shoulders. And the decision was made. Year number 7, here we come. The funny thing is, we were in probably worse shape than we've been in a long time. At that point, there was absolutely no child care. At that point, Sean Heitzman was coming to the end of his time with Celebrate Recovery. I mean, come on, guy's married, full-time job, working on his master's, doing an internship, and a new baby at the end of next month. What's the problem? He can't find time for us? Come on. And yet, faith is all I had at this point. So fast forwarding, Amy stepped up and took a large portion of things from me, including handling the child care. And I know that there are some individuals in here that have stepped up to fill some holes in child care. Can I give you a gratitude of thanks? Come on. Because I think what we forget in situations like this is as the adults come to Celebrate Recovery to fix their hurts, habits, and hang-ups, we forget that the kids are in the mix of all that. And for some children coming into CR, they don't understand the magnitude of what it's like to have a relationship with Christ. And they get to see that through our leaders and through our child care workers. I have one little girl that comes here on Friday nights, and she'll skip events like going to Navy Pier and movies and stuff like that because she'd rather be at Celebrate Recovery. And it gives us a chance to help them process kind of the muddle of what the families are going through. So thank you for thinking of our children. It is so important. Other leaders have stepped up and asked how they could help. We are still working on the tech side to figure that out, because obviously that's a big hole. So if you have any ideas or are looking to plug into that, come see me. I would love to be able to talk to you about it. We have needs, but I have faith. Through all this, I finally started to hear and was listening. How can you discount the transformed lives that have come from this ministry? Did you hear Robin's testimony? Thank you, Robin. Where's Robin? Thank you. She loves it when we call her out. Can I tell you that when Robin started, she came in last and left first. But she came. And God worked on her, and God, through Celebrate Recovery, helped transform her life to the point where she's going to come on as a leader. Transformed lives. Not to mention my own. How quickly Tim Sims forgot this. And it made me think, what if Trinity shut their doors? What if Trinity, during the years, based on financial reasons, based on numbers of attendees, based on whether or not they could start ministries or keep ministries running, what if the same people doing the same thing year after year, just gave up? What if the church shut down? Where would I be? Better yet, where would you be? I mean, you have to admit, we do a lot of great things here at Trinity. Amen? We've got our banners up here that reflect what we do. They're great core values. Let's talk about worship and prayer. Lord knows I have utilized this for 9.5 years. It has shown me how powerful prayer is during those bleak, dark situations. Worship and prayer is something that Trinity takes very serious. And I hope that everyone is able to experience the power of prayer. Can I remind you that we have a men's group that meets at 6:30 on Tuesday mornings? We have a prayer meeting at 7 p.m. on Wednesdays. And let us remember that church starts on Friday night at Celebrate Recovery. We can take a look at our grow over here, which means knowing and obeying God's word and understanding how it makes a daily difference in our lives. Gaining knowledge is vital, but we need more than information. Can we agree? We need application. This is how we fix things. Now, I know we've got some men in here that like to fix things, right? Actually, there's probably very few, right? Here's an example. We can go work on our cars, and I can do many things. I can go to the library. I can research on how to fix this certain part. I can get books. I can go onto YouTube and look at videos and see exactly how it's done. I can talk to other mechanics that have done it, other people in the church that maybe have done it, and say, oh, this is an easy way to do it. But the bottom line is, I can't fix it until I pick up the tool. Are you with me? Or just Pastor? Thanks, Pastor. I need some, you know, encouragement. And then we have our serve. Serve reminds us of our responsibility to work alongside our fellow believers. Our church is full of ministry and service opportunities. And guess what? Celebrate Recovery happens to be one of them. If you weren't part of the program today, okay? I want to thank personally Tim and Sherilyn Johnson and Jeff and Michelle Maminga, who alternate and fulfill our Friday night dinners on the first Friday of the month. Well, yeah. It is so great to see them on the first Friday of the month and have the opportunity to fellowship with them while they're serving our ministry. It is such a blessing. Not to mention, Tim Johnson is the one that goes to Starbucks and gets the snacks that we use on Friday night and sometimes is overflowed to the Sunday mornings. You know what? He has to go to the outlet mall, Starbucks, to get this. Have you guys been to the outlet mall? And he's going there just to get snacks for us to use. So I, you know, just thank you so much for your service. Amen. The thing is with this, is you may not need Celebrate Recovery, but that doesn't mean Celebrate Recovery doesn't need you. Now, go moves us outside the walls of the service, or out of the church, and into our community and world. It may mean we volunteer at Hesed House on every fifth Friday, or join in with Feed My Starving Children. Did you know that Celebrate Recovery is the strongest bridge between the Trinity and the community? True story. Okay. Did you know that Celebrate Recovery has been the greatest growth mechanism in the church for the past year and a half? Isn't that great news? And this growth I mean, the impact on our community through CR and the power of Jesus Christ will result in transformed lives, relationships with Christ, and most importantly, victory. Victory. Now, you may have noticed I skipped over the Connect one. Now, Connect uplifts the importance of worship, prayer, and fellowship in our everyday lives. Connect means to be vital in vital relationship with God, other believers, the church, and the family. It reminds us of the priority of building positive, long-lasting relationships with the people at work, in the school, and community, and at home. As we connect first with God, He makes it possible for us to build meaningful relationships with other believers. So let's talk about this. Connect is great, right? Amen. We're all about connection, right? Yeah. I mean, from the day I walked into this church on 1451 Raymond Drive, every pastor and person I came into contact with told me, stressed to me, and shared with me the importance of a one-on-one relationship with Jesus Christ. Am I wrong? Am I in the right church? Okay. It was not sugar-coated. I was given scripture to tell me that. I heard it in the worship time. I heard it in the prayer time. I heard it in the sermons. I heard it loud and clear. So I gave my life to Christ, and I started that relationship. And through the years, I have built on that relationship, and it was a game changer, and I have never, never been the same since. Amen. Paul Sloan, no comments from you. Okay. Today, I can tell you with my whole heart that I love the Lord. It is the first relationship of true love between a father and his son. I love him for what he has done in my life, and I owe him my life. I can tell you that I believe my relationship with him is solid. I can tell you that I am connected with the church and with so many wonderful people here. And what wonderful relationships have come from this because of him. I have a ton of faith these days instead of hopelessness. I pray to him about things instead of for things. I serve and I share his good word the best I can. I have everything. A strong, intimate, one-on-one relationship with Christ. A strong faith, a strong marriage, strong relationships, strong prayers, and strong godly counsel through the pastor and his staff, and so many other people within this church. And by now, you probably are thinking, what does this have to do with Celebrate Recovery? Well, I'm going to tell you. Are you ready? Yes. How many of you can say they have everything? A strong, intimate, one-on-one relationship with Christ, a strong faith, strong marriage, strong relationships, strong prayers, and strong godly counsel through the pastor and his wonderful staff, and with so many people in this church. Now, I'm not looking for a raise of hands, but ask yourself, who has this? For the most part, a lot of you might say, I do. Great. What if having all that wasn't enough? What if having all of that wasn't enough? What if you pray all the time, you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you have strong marriages and strong relationships, you call the pastor or a staff member and get godly counsel, you talk to people in the church, yet it's not enough? Maybe you're still angry about something. Maybe you're still having trouble with either giving or accepting forgiveness. Maybe you've lost a loved one. Is there something causing you pain? Are you experiencing emotional or verbal abuse? Do you have anxiety, depression, codependency? What if the internet has more control over you than you have over it? Better yet, are there lemons in your life and you just don't know how to make lemonade? I can tell you, if you have all these things, a strong, intimate, one-on-one relationship with Christ, a strong faith, strong marriage, strong relationships, strong prayers, and strong godly counsel from the pastor and his staff and the rest of the church, and you're still struggling with things, I am sorry. So sorry. Because it's no fun. But, there's good stuff coming. Come on. There is great news. Okay, I just want to inform you guys, there is a backdoor solution. Okay? You can come to the other church where those other people go. Let me tell you, it is at the same place that you're already comfortable with. There might even be some familiar faces. And I can tell you, it will transform your life. If you allow it. If you allow it. What we do on Friday nights at Celebrate Recovery is transform the willing. Because sometimes all that other stuff isn't enough. Celebrate Recovery was designed as a program to help those struggling with hurts, habits, and hang-ups by showing them the loving power of Jesus Christ through a recovery process. Did you hear that, church? That was perfect. A process. This is done through teaching and application, which results in a process. Scripture tells us, all have sinned. Isaiah 53:6, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. In Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is in my nature to sin, and it is yours too. None of us are untainted. Because of sin, we've all hurt ourselves, we've all hurt other people, and others have hurt us. This means each of us need repentance and recovery in order to live our lives the way God intended. Now, we already read 53:6, but we have to keep reading. Isaiah 53:7 says, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. And Romans 3:24, and all are justified freely by the grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Amen. I'm sure you've heard the expression that time heals all wounds. Malarkey. Unfortunately, it is untrue. I frequently talk with people who are still carrying hurts from 30 or 40 years ago. The truth is, time often makes things worse. Good news, though. Celebrate Recovery is forward-looking. Can I repeat that? Because I like to repeat things on Friday night. Okay. Celebrate Recovery is forward-looking. Rather than wallowing in the past or dredging up and rehearsing painful memories over and over, Celebrate Recovery focuses on the future. Regardless of what has already happened, The solution is to start making wise choices now and depend on Christ's power to help make those changes. Celebrate Recovery program emphasizes personal responsibility. You mean it's not everybody else's fault? Instead of playing the accuse and excuse game of victimization. This program helps people face up to their own poor choices and deal with what they can do something about. We cannot control all that happens to us, but we can control how we respond to everything. That is a secret of happiness. When we stop wasting the time fixing the blame, we have more energy to fix the problem. When you stop hiding your own faults and stop hurling accusations at others, then the healing power of Christ can begin working in your mind, your will, and your emotions. You have heard me and Pastor Steve talk about hurts, habits, and hang-ups plenty of times. A hurt, habit, or hang-up is anything that may be hindering your walk with God. Amen? It's a good thing nobody in here has any of those, right? So let me tell you what a hurt is. Hurts are emotional reaction we experience to another person's behavior or some disappointing or disturbing situation. Example, abuse, abandonment, divorce, grief, relationship issues, or codependency. Habits are addictions to something or someone that control your thoughts and actions. And you thought it was just a chemical. Habits are addictions to something or someone that controls your thoughts and actions. Example, alcoholism, substance abuse, food addiction, gambling, sex, shopping, tobacco, dysfunctional relationships. And then we have hang-ups. Hang-ups are the negative mental attitudes that are used to cope with difficult people or adversities. Anger, depression, fear, anxiety, resentment, or unforgiveness. Well, I'm feeling pretty comfortable now. How much more time we got now? So as I wrap it up, these are life problems that are common to many people in today's culture. They can easily become stumbling blocks that cause our hearts to harden and turn us away from seeking God. Celebrate Recovery helps us turn these difficulties around and instead use them as stepping stones to a life of victory and faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. So here's the tough question. And I would love for you to be honest, get your hands up as high as possible. I'm asking you, who here has a hurt, a habit, or a hang-up? Great. I'll see you on Friday night at 7.
I couldn't have said it better myself. Tim, that was fabulous, and thank you for being obedient. I think everybody in this room knows that God is working through you. And the one thing that I kept thinking about, people don't know how much spiritual attack is on Celebrate Recovery around the country. It's not just here. Satan knows that the one thing that this world needs is hope and healing. If there's one thing that Trinity can offer our community, it's Celebrate Recovery. I could stand up here and share with you statistics about our city, about our town, about our county, and I shared it with the leadership team, and they know that I have begged them, to recognize that Satan doesn't want this. We're on the right track because we know how much we're experiencing against it. And all I kept thinking was, you know what? We crush that nasty Satan. We crush him with our heel. I just picture Mary sitting in the second row. We crush him. We crush him. That's what she'd say, because we do. And I'm telling you right now, the amount of barriers that we've experienced, the amount of barriers that the team has experienced, it just shows and proves that Satan doesn't want this to happen. But man, how we have relied on the strength of the Lord. Folks, when we started Celebrate Recovery, it was for Trinity. I think we forgot that. When it started 7 years ago, it started as a ministry to offer to the people here at Trinity, because we believe that a part of our spiritual growth and a part of our spiritual awakening even is to deal with the hurts, the habits, and the hang-ups. So we offered this as a ministry. And then the leadership team of Celebrate Recovery was really confused because nobody in the church showed up. But then we put this red sign outside with white letters, and it said, Celebrate Recovery on 7 o'clock on Friday nights. You ask anybody that has ever been to this church for Celebrate Recovery, how did you get here? The number one response, I saw your sign. I saw your sign. And church, I'm telling you right now, a part of my vision as the pastor of the church for 2016 is to see Celebrate Recovery offered to our people in our church, offered to the people in our community, so that we can see the hope and healing that God wants to offer and extends to us. It's to see transformed lives. Robin knows I've said it, but I want more Robins. I'm so selfish. I am so selfish because I want to see God. When people choose to do the possible, God does the impossible. That's what I want. That's what I want. And so we're going to close. And I think that the most important thing I hope that you heard today, and again, I'll just reiterate it. We have tried our best to remove the barriers and the walls. I want you to know there's one thing that the team takes so serious. It's anonymity. I can tell you, I've been here for 4 years. Never once have I seen confidentiality broken. Not once. There have been times where I have asked Tim point blank, hey, was this person here on Friday? And he goes, and he just looks at me and I go, oh yeah, that's right. You're not going to tell me. Folks, we believe that God has provided Trinity with an opportunity to make a really big impact in your life and the life of those around us. There are two churches in Naperville that do an incredible job at Celebrate Recovery, Compass Church and Trinity Church of the Nazarene. People know us because we're a place of hope and healing. And I can tell you that those two ministries have been, in the last year and a half, just absolutely attacked. Leadership at Compass Church has had to step down because they just don't have the ability to keep doing what they were doing. And so they had to literally look at it, their entire group and their men's group and say, we can't offer a leader here anymore. Now somebody had stepped up, praise the Lord. I don't ever want to stand in front of this congregation and say, sorry, folks, but we can't continue to do this anymore. Because, as Tim said, the single greatest growth mechanism that this church has experienced in the last year and a half has been on Friday nights at 7 o'clock. To see people who we have prayed for, who you are praying for, and to know that we're making a difference in the community around us, we are seeing it happen at 7 o'clock on Friday nights. And the best part is, people are now starting to realize, wait a minute, I can trust this church. They don't just love me on Friday night at 7, they love me at 9 and 10:45 and 6:30 in the morning and 7 o'clock on Wednesdays. When I'm with them, they show great love for me. And I will tell you this, we will always be known as a church that will show great love. If you come to Trinity and you don't experience that love, you come and you tell me, because I'll help that other, I'll help the person who hurt you find another church. I'm not kidding. I will. Because if there's one thing that we can offer this broken world, it's hope and healing. And we have that opportunity. So stand with me as we close. Let's extend our hands and receive this incredible blessing that God has bestowed on us today and for the rest of this week. And Trinity family, I ask that if you know it as well, that you would say it with me. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. You are sent.